It's the Daily Dog.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for being here on the Daily Dog today. Happy that you are here. So today is going to be special because I get to do a little teaching today. We are going to do a guided analysis, musical analysis of a piece by Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Yesterday was Mozart's 265th birthday, so I've got Mozart on the brain. And as a professor, I've taught composition and harmony and voice leading and how to do analysis and orchestration for a lot of years. And this is the type of piece, Ave Verum Corpus by Mozart, that I would give an undergraduate course as maybe like a final or towards the end of the semester in like the second semester of full musicianship courses. This is after we've learned about modulations and phrases and cadences and all that sort of stuff. And a lot of people that are studying this often have difficulty trying to figure out what Roman numeral do I put where and why, and when does it become a modulation, when does it not, those sorts of things. So I want to talk through this a little bit and give you my perspective as to how this works and what sort of things you should be asking yourself. And then if you've studied properly and can answer these musical questions accurately, then you'll be fine. So let's start off and take a look at this piece. This is Ave Verum Corpus by Mozart. You're going to hear it as a boys choir is singing it, and I think organ in the background. We'll stop and start as we go, and I'll lay out a few things. Okay, here we go. String orchestra behind us. Now they start singing. So that is the first phrase. Think of when we talk about phrases in music, like we do in grammar. These are complete thoughts that have a musical punctuation. So this is four measures, which is common in classical era music, especially for Mozart. And Mozart has ended this phrase on the tonic chord, the one chord. This is in D major. And he's ended it here on the word corpus on a D major chord. And this is an authentic cadence because the key that we're in is D, and we're landing on D as the end of this musical phrase. And because the D is going to be preceded by its dominant chord in an inversion, but an A chord, its five chord, then this is a five chord, a dominant chord that's moving to a one chord at the cadence. It's an authentic cadence in that it verifies or lands on the tonic chord or the one chord in that particular key. And then we keep going. So four more measures. And then we have another cadence. This is also common. These phrases are the same length. We would call that a symmetrical period, right? Because both of these phrases have the same length. Now this phrase ends on an A chord. We haven't changed keys, but it's a different punctuation, right? The first one landed on D, the second one landed on A. Now A is the five chord in the key of D, so this becomes a half cadence. It's like a musical question or a comma, right? And it's building us to sort of think that, okay, we're not finished, we're not landing on the one chord, there's some answer or some continuation that needs to take place. And so off we go into the next phrase. Gloria, Excellent. So that's the end of that particular other two phrases, right? So this ends on omine on another A chord. So people might be thinking, hey, that's another five chord. That's five. But it's not. Because we have modulated to the key of A by this time. So this A chord, when it lands on it here in this measure, it's not acting as the five chord in the key of D, it's acting as the one chord in the key of A. So how do we go back and figure out how we moved from the key of D to the key of A? Let's go back to the beginning of this next little set of phrases. On vere passum, this starts off on an A chord that continues from the half cadence that we were just in. Remember, in measure eight, that virgine, that A chord that we landed on, is a half cadence in the key of D. So that A chord is acting as five in the key of D. But when we keep going, you'll notice that all of the G's that are included in this become G sharps instead of G naturals. It first happens in the soprano, happens again in the soprano, a couple of G sharps in the alto. And what that does is it changes the collection of pitches that are being used. In D major, the collection of pitches only has two sharps. But in A major, the collection of pitches has three sharps. That third sharp is G sharp, right? So because as soon as we start using all G sharps all the time in this next phrase, Mozart is starting this next phrase in the key of A. He ends one phrase in the key of D with a half cadence, and then he takes that same A chord and he turns it into a one chord. So I would call this a phrase modulation, or a modulation that happens on a phrase, or at the end of a phrase and before another one starts. So on vere passum, I would start thinking of that as a tonic chord in the key of A. Now, Mozart has not changed his key signature. So you think, well, didn't Mozart know that the key of A major is in three sharps? Of course he did. But he's set these two sharps for the key signature for this piece. And classical composers, a lot of them do this, especially in shorter pieces. They'll change keys without ever changing the key signature. So that's not always a for sure indication that a modulation has happened. So on vere passum, that's going to be a one chord. And then on passum, it gets to using that G sharp, that's going to be an E chord, right? So that becomes five of A. So it's now just a one chord and a five chord in the key of A instead of in the key of D. As we keep going on immolatum, we're using that E7 chord, which is 5-7 in this key now, to resolve to this F sharp minor chord. And that's going to be a deceptive resolution, or in this case, at the end of this four measure phrase, a deceptive cadence. And he helps it along by giving it a little boost with F sharp's own leading tone chord. This chord that has E sharp and G sharp and B and D natural, that's going to be seven fully diminished seven of six in the key of A. Right? That E sharp is the root of the chord, and it's going to lead to F sharp. And F sharp in the key of A is the sixth scale degree, or relative minor. Right? Let's listen to this again. That's a one chord in A. 5-4-3. 5-7. Seven fully diminished, seven to six. And then that D harkens back to the original. But it's just a full cadence in the key of A, right? So at the end of this next set of bars, we're now fully in the key of A, and they haven't included the interlude here, but this Kuyu starts another really interesting section. Listen to this. It starts on the A major chord. Weird. Now that sounds interesting. That's another cadence, right? But that doesn't look like any cadence that we know of in the key of D or A. But what does it sound like? We've got perforatum, right? We've got this perforatum. It's a C dominant seventh chord. And then it's resolving to an F major chord. That sounds like 5-7-1 in the key of F, right? So don't try to still think about this in the key of D, right? That is a C7 chord moving to an F major chord. That is 5-1 in the key of F. It's not, you know, don't try to get cute with like, okay, the C is like flat 7 in the key of D, so that's like a 7-7 chord moving to flat 3. In a sense, you're making the calculations correctly, but you're not recognizing what Mozart is doing and moving the music to another spot. So he's got us giving us this phrase that ends us in F major. So what relationship does F major have to D or A? D major or A major? Not much. It's a distantly related key to both of those. But F major is also the relative major of D minor, right? With one flat. And that's where he's going to move us. So by the end of this next phrase, he's going to move us to an A major chord that's going to be another half cadence in D. It's going to sound like it should be in D minor, but he's going to move us to D major afterwards. So he starts with this G4-2. And then a tonicized half cadence. And now we're back in D. Okay, we're almost done. So let's go back and take a look through that. Let me back up a little bit here. Now that he's back in D, he is not going to be modulating away from D for the rest of the piece. There is still some chromaticism, but we're not modulating away from D for the rest of the piece. But he does give us a really interesting sequence. So a sequence is when we take this musical idea and repeat it at different pitch levels. So if you take a look at this, this Esto Nobis is gonna go for two bars, and then he's gonna do the exact same thing on Pregustatum, up a step, right? So the sopranos and altos sing this in parallel thirds, and then they do the exact same thing for parallel thirds for another two measures. He harmonizes that brilliantly with the exact same motive, right? This little motive, right? With the basses and tenors singing again in parallel thirds. He starts us off with the D and the F sharp here. He goes down by a fifth to G and B. And just like the sopranos and altos went up a step to E and G from where they started, the basses and tenors go from G to B up to A and C sharp. And by the time we get done with that little sequential pattern, he then gives us a move to a cadence where this sets up A major moving to 1. But again, it's another deceptive cadence. It's another deceptive cadence here. Sorry. There we go. And there's a sequence. The lower voices follow a fifth lower and a measure behind. Five, six, five, a five, to a cadential pattern that has a deceptive resolution. Now, if you've studied deceptive cadences or deceptive resolutions, what do you think? Okay, that's a five chord going to six, right? Well, this one isn't the six chord, right? A deceptive resolution is a five chord that gets set up to go to one that just goes somewhere other than one. This happens to be on this chord here. This is a G inverted chord, a G over B, right? So that's like the 4-6 chord instead of the actual sixth chord, which would be B minor. This B down here is not the root of the chord, it's the third of the chord, but it still allows it to be a root position, a deceptive resolution. And then Mozart gives us this glorious little ending phrase. Let's hear it. And the instruments have a final little spot there. So how do I know that this last little phrase, even though it has a whole bunch of chromaticism in it, is not modulating or part of a different key? I know it because of how the phrase endings work, by where the cadences are. If you look to the end of this, it's still cadences in D. So I don't have to try to figure out if there's a modulation in the middle of this phrase, because I know that by the end of the phrase, we're still in D where we started. So I'm going to use secondary dominance and my understanding of how chromaticism works within the context of D major to analyze these chords. So let's take a look at it. It starts off with mortise, right? This chord here, we think of it being a D major chord, but he's added this lowered seventh. Right? So we've taken this D major chord, we've made it a D7 chord. It's in second inversion, right? So this would be D4-3. But the C natural isn't part of the D major scale or the D major key. It's borrowing that C natural from a key signature with one sharp instead of two. So this D becomes a 5 chord of G. And G in the key of D is 4. So this becomes 5 of 4. So we write 5 and then a slash and then 4 on the bottom, right? Because this in this instance, he's using the dominant of the 4 chord, in this case, the G chord. It's in an inversion. So if I'm showing the inversions, that would be 5-4-3 of a 4, right? And he does go to 4, but he goes to minor 4. Check this out. He uses a B natural here in the B flat instead of a B natural. So this becomes a G minor chord. That's modal mixture, not a secondary dominant, right? A minor chord cannot function as a dominant sound. Right, so him going from the major four chord to the minor four chord, we would just write a minor four chord instead of a major four chord, right? In this instance, minor 4-6, because it's in first inversion. And then when we go to this next chord, oh, now it gets tricky. Now we've got two accidentals. So how would I do this? I would just take an inventory of what's there and see if I can figure out what the chord is by stacking it in thirds. And the way that this would stack in thirds, D sharp would be the root, F sharp would be the third, the A would be the fifth, and the C natural would be the seventh, right? If I stack those all in thirds, those are all minor thirds. It's a symmetrical chord. It is a D sharp, fully diminished seventh chord. So I figured that out, right? But D sharp is not in the key of D. So D sharp, because this is a leading tone chord, a fully diminished seventh chord, I got to figure out what note D sharp is leading tone to. And D sharp is leading tone to E. And E is the second scale degree in the key of D. So I would call this chord 7 fully diminished 4-3 of 2. And people said musicians can't do math, right? But it's basically, the Roman numeral allows us to show that in this particular instance, Mozart is using an extra bit of tonicization to give color in leading us to the next chord, which is going to be the 2 chord, right? So this D sharp is going to resolve up to that E, which is very nice. The 7th of the chord is going to resolve down by step, very good. And so we move to the two chord, except it's not a two chord. When is a two chord not a two chord? When it's the five of five. So now this is an E chord, and an E chord is the second scale degree in the key of D, but because, you know, it's a major chord now, actually E dominant. There's E, G sharp, there's B's, and there's D's. These two little C sharps are passing tones and not part of that particular chord. So this is an E dominant chord in first inversion. I would call it 5-6-5 of five, because E is the dominant of A, and A is the five chord in the key of D. See how this works? If you go through the steps and just do them correctly, then it should start to roll off the tongue, and the more you do it, the more you'll get better at it. So this next measure is, this bass note is a G natural. It looks like a tie, it's actually a slur. So this is changing to a G natural. So now we've got A, C sharp, E, and G natural. That is the A7 chord. It's not a secondary dominant. There's no chromatic notes in there. It is the 5-7 chord. It's in third inversion. So I might call it 5-4-2 and expect the seventh of that chord, this G, to resolve down by step. You know, good job, Mozart. So we've got 5-4-2 going to 1-6. And then this is 4-6, and then an embellished A chord, this cadential pattern that some people call it, back to 1, and it's a perfect authentic cadence at the end. So there's a lot of stuff in here, but every time we use this or use these tools, it's allowing us to agree on the terminology for how the music is being written, what tools are being used, and how, and it allows us to start to ask questions about the composer's intent, the composer's decision-making process, how they're treating a specific word, and just sort of be able to talk back and forth on the same playing field with our other musicians to be able to discuss what we like and what we don't about how the music works and why it sounds the way that it does. Woo! You think you could handle that on a musicianship 2 or theory 2 final? That's kind of what we're looking for from freshmen and sophomores in college that are dealing with this. So I hope that's helpful. If you have any questions about what I was doing or disagree with anything of what I was doing, I'd love to hear that. If you would like extra help, I am available for tutoring. How about that? I love teaching this stuff. I love the puzzle making part of all of this. So it's interesting to me, and I would be happy to help you if you have questions or are struggling with understanding this stuff and you really want to get better at it. So there you go. Ave Verum Corpus by Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. It's a great piece. It's there's not a wrong note in the whole thing. And it's very beautiful. So thanks for listening, and we will see you next time on The Daily Doug.